The Kremlin marked the history of Russia and how she used her power. One of Lagatov's staff led him up the short flight of concrete steps and through to the president's private office. It was empty. The door was closed. Grizlov was left alone. On the left side of the room, against the wall behind the desk, the national white, blue, and red Russian flag hung from a stand. Another flag with the Russian Federation's coat of arms, the double-headed golden eagle, was to the right. The room displayed elegance without ostentation. There were tall windows with dark yellow drapes and a chandelier over the president's dark wood desk, with a table and two upright tapestried chairs on the other side for visitors. The desk itself was tidy. There was a writing surface, a keyboard, a large screen to the left, and holders for three phones. Lenin, Stalin, and Putin had all used the Senate building. They had decorated, rebuilt, torn things down, and renovated to their tastes. The self-effacing President Viktor Lagutov had simply moved in, changed nothing, and got down to work. He had begun as an interim ruler, a technocratic pair of hands to guide the nation to its next stage of revival. It had been assumed another charismatic strongman would take over the reins. Yet Lagutov had seen off three American presidents and countless European leaders. He projected diffidence, appeared to lack enthusiasm for the job, and faced no serious challengers. Grizlov had expected Lagutov to come in through a side door from the restroom or another area of his office. But the main doors opened, and the Russian president walked in, deep in conversation with Gavril Navrosky, ignoring Grizlov until they reached the center of the office.